Okay, calling to order a meeting of the advisory committee Tuesday, May 14th at 6:30 p.m. I'm actually going to call Ann Hurd so she can participate remotely. We have a physical quorum present.
Hello, Brian.
Hi, Ann. I have you on speakerphone. We just called the meeting to order. Sure. We just called the meeting to order. And on the agenda, the first item is a review of annual town meeting and the advisory process. And then after that, we have some transfer requests and any other advisory business.
Okay.
Everybody is here except Joe, but I believe he's on his way. Do you have Joe's cell phone? Maybe you just text him?
Okay. I'm going to hand him.
Yeah, but she's on her phone. Okay. It's hard to text.
Oh.
And then, Ann, Selectman Bob Zakansky is also here, too.
Good evening.
All right, so the first item is very open-ended, and I just kind of wanted to open it up to everyone here and to you for comments on the way town meeting went, also comments on the advisory committee process throughout the budget season. And also, I'm always willing to receive specific comments about what the chair could be doing better as well.
I was just surprised before the meeting of the errors that were in the warrant. I don't know how those can be previewed and who many times they checked over because we caught it right away.
Aren't we required this year to have the warrants or to have the our stuff in? Single week or so earlier, yes. We didn't get a final copy.
I was expecting to get a text while I was driving here.
He just called me meeting about 30 seconds ago.
Yeah, and Ann's on speakerphone. Yeah, so I think this was when Monday we came up at a selectman meeting where Don had mentioned that the warrant closed a week earlier this year than it did last year, so there was a bit of a time crunch, and that maybe next year they're going to try to. Or maybe it was that your last board selectman's meeting was a week earlier in March than last year's.
Yeah, I think legally, I don't know if it's a legal restriction as much as a printer restriction. But there have been times in the past where there's been a selectman's meeting, like there was at the same time in March as this year, but because of so many controversies and uncertainties, another selectman's meeting is added for the night before you absolutely have to close the warrant. Okay?
Yep.
And that just wasn't necessary this year. There wasn't any uncertainty or a lot of controversy around any of the articles. I would just add that in a situation where that happens and things are really up in the air, what the advisory commonly does is have a vote at its prior meeting to give the people who are representing advisory at that last selectman's meeting permission to change or withdraw any recommendations. And change it to recommendation to get it on the floor or something like that. So you have that prerogative.
There were some things that were actually.
I don't think it was a question of our vote.
Yeah.
I think it was a question of the content of the warrant to be match what we were voting on.
I'm not sure I'm aware of this.
Yeah.
The summary that you mentioned?
No, it was
a few of the articles.
So, yeah. On one of the articles, the title of the article for the fire department, the fire chief's vehicle, referred to as a one-ton pickup, when what was voted on by us and what was discussed with the fire chief was a three-quarter-ton vehicle.
Yeah.
That was one issue.
Without a plow.
Without a plow.
Where it's in summary.
Right. And then
the 2008 expedition was represented.
2005 expedition.
one of the changes that were made at the last minute when we came out of a review, and we changed them and talked to the fire chief, and we also talked to Joe on some of the changes after we had done some research around these vehicles. And so that got switched within 2 weeks.
But that wasn't right before the lot closed, was it?
I don't remember. I have to look back at the dates, but I'm not sure that the changes that were necessarily forwarded so that it got it. But we were all surprised. We were recommending these vehicles, and all of a sudden it was new ones.
Right.
Which is great, which is what we were recommending. But I think there was some confusion there.
Yeah, but whatever is in there, I mean, the language in the article should be exactly what you voted on.
Right.
And if it changes in any way, you should be notified so you can vote on it again.
Yeah, we were.
Right. Well, we weren't, and so
I guess
we caught it.
I guess we changed it at the meeting, what we were recommending. But those changes didn't get reflected in the warrant.
No, had we not caught it, then it would have been misrepresented at town meeting as to what we really voted on, because the wording was incorrect.
Right.
So I know Doug took care of it there, but it all went home to people.
The warrant should go out with the language that everybody has voted on.
Came up with the person. We voted on some modifications to the as proposed article, and whether our voting language got captured and transferred to the people writing the warrant. I don't know. Was it in the minutes? Because the detail that we think was in the minutes should have been in the minutes. Well, no, if it was in the minutes, was the detail that we expect or hope for.
Well, it was related to everything.
Somewhere
in the change in direction.
Broke down. Yep.
One meeting to the next, and then they changed back, so we were completely.
It wasn't the minutes. The issue, though, was that because it was such a quick turnaround, like we met and voted on a Tuesday, and then they were reviewing the warrant on a Thursday. Our minutes hadn't been reviewed and approved, so it was just...
And maybe they were here. I don't
yeah,
know.
It's like...
Maybe the selectmen were here. I don't know the issues.
Yeah.
It was back and forth, and it was very confusing, so we need to just make sure that...
I don't recall, I could be corrected on this, but I don't recall the selectmen changing the wording on any...
No,
but we had recommended something, and they wanted us to research new stuff, used equipment, used stuff.
That's a different issue. And we're talking about the, I think specifically and by example, the fire chief's vehicle.
Right.
That we took what was in the warrant article, draft warrant article, and we modified it.
Right.
And I don't know who was in the room, I don't know.
Right, and what you're speaking of is DPW, I think.
Well,
it's both,
actually.
Yeah,
the modification. We're looking at a bunch of
just
things about fire and DPW and it was just done at the last minute because we had agreed on something and then we were asked to research something else. So I think it was very much at the last minute.
But to our credit, we did, when we went after another week or whatever, we saw the thing in the article, after it got mailed to the house, and we said, wow, it still says the one time, it still says the fire and a snowboard or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, anyway,
there's something already,
but we...
Wasn't there also a question of both?
My phone.
Your phone, yes.
Right, and then there were a couple of that I wasn't here.
Right.
I wasn't even here. And you guys voted and recommended things, and it showed that it was 6-0.
Well, some of that is undoubtedly my fault because I was so far behind with the minutes. Because I had the attendance recorded properly, but the minutes didn't go out until very late.
I have something else.
Yeah.
I know we do a lot of research, and maybe some of us do more than others. And we do get a chance to look at the warrant pretty early. I think that it doesn't make us look so, I don't know, I don't want to use the wrong word, cohesive, or the fact that we know what the hell we're doing if we vote on one thing at this table, and then at town meeting, we vote differently. We change our vote.
Well, the recommendation of the
I just think that more research should be done if we sit at this table and we have a chance to talk to everyone and look at everything and just read it and say, okay, yes, I'm happy with that. May not be the way to go about it. You might have to take every little thing, because if you're sitting there, we're supposed to be recommending something, and then we decide to change our minds at the next minute somebody else says a few little things that we go, oh, wow, well, I never thought of it that way, really doesn't make us look too good. I mean, I wouldn't have that much faith in an advisory board if they voted all one way and then members start changing at home town floor. Myself. And I don't know if anybody else wants to.
That's
I see where you're coming from, but I have not watched the video of the town meeting, sadly, but it sounds like more information came to light between while we were voting and the town meeting floor, or at least more considerations that maybe we didn't pick up. I don't think it's necessarily inappropriate for our board members to change their mind given the discussion at town meeting, at least occasionally. Certainly wouldn't want to have it all the time. And certainly we don't want to have it happen if there's no new information in town meeting, because then there's no sense in that.
Okay.
I think what they're talking about, Connie, unless maybe you have a specific example, I think this has happened in the past, too, that people have changed their minds.
I only remember one time that someone changed their minds while I was on the board, their mind while I was on the board in 7 years. And Bob was on the board at the same time. That's a long time
ago. Oh, yeah, that was a long time.
And the gentleman ended up quitting
the
board. But that was the only time I remember.
But there was one time when I was on advisory, and I voted for something in advisory in preparation for town meeting. And I learned more about it, and I stood up at town meeting, and I announced changing my vote in
your spot. That's a great way to do it. If you stand up and say, I did, now that I know this, I want to change my vote when everyone does.
Yeah.
You know, because I think.
But when you do that, and this is what I did, you don't do it from
the table.
No, you have to go up
to the microphone, because at that point you're just another citizen,
right,
and you have to wait in line for everybody else. But that's which is what I did. But I did that because I wanted to convince people. I think there have been multiple times when I voted one way in committee, and when it gets down to the floor, you sit there and you're going, you know, maybe this isn't a good idea to spend this money right now, like on an article or something like that. And you go, no. I think so long as, you know, there's going to be a lot of times when the advisory committee is challenged on the votes it does make, so long as it can substantiate those in the eyes of the voters. I think individuals peeling off on the occasional issue is not a big deal. I mean, it's,
okay.
You know, someone did it. You feel like the system broke when I did that, so.
No.
And you want to talk about the new vehicle signal, and then the used vehicle signal, and then the new vehicle signal that we received?
Yeah, well, that's what I was referring to earlier, and I think that may have made some of the, you know, the behind some of the errors that finally got into the warrant, because it was, I can't even remember where it was and related to when the warrant was actually closed. But it was all last minute, you know.
Okay, I guess my takeaway this week
listened to the departments. They requested new vehicles. We came to an advisory meeting, and we heard from one or more board of selectmen that there's nothing wrong with used vehicles, and some other people probably can offer that advice as well. So Ann and I carried the sword, went to various departments, and explained and persuaded and kind of left it into the hands of the director. And
they did a lot of research with us on what would be possible.
We scoped out prices, models, and it all seemed reasonable. You know, nothing to be ashamed of buying a recently used vehicle. But then we come to the next advisory meeting, and the same person that was recommending use seemed to have changed their mind.
And what I remember
is, it was kind of embarrassing because why did we have all the meetings we had?
But that was within. That did not happen on the floor of town meeting.
No, but the thing is, there was no.
That's the process.
Particular selectmen did not even give you a reason as to why there was a change, right?
No, I never. We did, and I think we just as happy with the change was more in line with our original recommendations in the first place. But it just was a little bit of a who's on first.
Strange.
Oh, we learned a lot, didn't we, Ted?
Yeah.
Way to make lemonade. I'm happy to just keep discussing this for as long as folks want.
I think another key learning is if, and I learned this from a person in China that I dealt with, seeing is believing. And when somebody says, well, I have a letter that says, or the document says, or it has this condition, check it out. May I please see the letter? May I please see the document? What's the MGL that lets you do that? Show me the vehicle. Yeah. And
I do think that the
look at the
process is better this year than it did the previous year as you get to know the departments better, and there's some merit for sticking with the liaison connections we had, because I know more now than I did last year around DPW. I'm liaison with you on the police department. You're the police department liaison, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and we didn't really get a chance. We met with them, but we really didn't get a chance to dig deeper, and I think we need to do that next year.
I think we did much better this year than we did last year because the police department, and they were kind of, I don't even think that the chief was the chief yet. He was still voting on, that was 2 years ago. So I feel like this year we had a better meeting with them than we've ever had.
I agree with you, but you know, Joe, Ted and I met several times throughout the year with Joe, and you learn more every time you sit down and understand what their challenges are, what's going well, where they're having difficulty, grants that may be in the works. So I think just as a note for going forward, we probably should make an effort to do that with all the departments that we liaise with, especially those that are such large and complex ones.
Well, I think we did that with the fire, and I just don't think that if I have to go there 3 or 4 times, it behooves them with their time with their department. If we can cover everything in an hour meeting, right?
If you
can do it once, you can do that. Yeah, we covered pretty much.
Yeah. I would think it would be easier to do it with a buyer now.
With the new chief,
because we had problems where John Benson wasn't around, or
meeting with Joe as liaisons 2 or 3 times throughout the year, so that we were more conversant with what the challenges were and what the spreadsheet for future expenditures were. So it gave us a little more background. We never did it as a team with the police department, but we did have that meeting with the fire department. It was everybody. I just want to believe the town could meet like that, but it was a relief on the other staff, is all I'm saying. And I know you had a hard week, so I'm not complaining, but you might want to make an extra effort to do that.
I want to make a couple comments about the liaison process, and we don't have to figure this all out tonight, but I think it's really difficult to strike the right balance between enough interaction where we feel like we get all the information we want and all the questions that we want answered without it becoming a burden or an interference. And I think that toward the end of our budget cycle, we might have started to merge into burdensome territory, and I don't blame anybody here for that, but I think that we just need to continually think about whether we're going about our contacts with the department heads in the most efficient way for them and for us. And this reminds me of an issue we talked about last August, which is I think everybody here might have slightly different thresholds when it comes to how much information do you need before you're willing to vote yes or no on something. And so I think, like, and it might even differ depending on what we're talking about. Like, you might want a ton of information about one article, and then a different article you're like, oh, I'm good with that, and I might feel differently. And I just think we need to make sure that we're not burdening department heads, because the two most important things in the liaison process when it comes to meeting is quality of information and relationships. We want really good quality information, and we want to maintain good relationships with the department heads. So I just want us to make sure we continue to talk about making sure the liaison process doesn't, you know, run afoul of those objectives.
Well, I feel like I would like to be able to talk with everyone before we all reach out to our departments. That way, I might have a concern that you could bring if you're a liaison and I'm not to a particular department.
Yes.
And I thought wasting time to come back. It's not I need to know what's going on in your department and can I help you with all your problems and all. But that's not our job.
Right.
We're supposed to take what is in the warrant or their budget and go from that. I think. Maybe I'm wrong. But I don't think that I need to know all about every little thing that they do in their department and be the person
that
they need.
Well, I will
say, Ted very wisely and helpfully sent me an email with his concerns about the conservation budget, which was pretty dramatic until we realized we were counting the same $6,000 twice. And so I went over those points very carefully with them. And so that was the equivalent of what Connie was talking about, having specific concerns. I think we should continue that practice.
I want to compliment Brian on the charts use of the ATM. I thought it was presented all the data in a logical, flowing way that made sense. Basically, it was last year's enhancements, but I continue that. The other thing that I think was very good is the joint capital planning advisory meetings rather early on. Mm-hmm. And I think we still need to look at kind of roles and responsibilities of, capital planning versus advisory. What is the work product of capital planning before it gets handed off or vice versa? But, where's the dividing thing? Because some of us who have project experience and are kind of engineers can't help it. Kind of want to get into that, more of that end of it, maybe we should or shouldn't have.
Well, I think we've gone to a good place, but I agree with you, Ted, when we've raised the pulse for a little bit better coordination earlier.
I'm not sure I understand all of that. Okay.
I don't want to, beat a dead horse here, but what you just said made me think that, again, there's a difference between I think there's a difference between how much information we feel we need to be able to vote on something versus above and beyond that, can we as individuals offer any services to people if they want them? So, for example, I think it'd be very different, and I'm using this as an example, I'm not saying you did this, but if you feel like you've gotten enough information to be able to vote yes or no on something, but you think, hey, Joe, I could actually really help you, like, dig into research on something. Do you want my help? I think if we distinguish between those two efforts, we might not feel like we're stepping on toes, because instead of it feeling like we're micromanaging, it's they've invited us in to help. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
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 That helps me a lot.
Did you have any thoughts?
Yeah. For example, I'm here tonight because I was not very involved in the last budget process. I want to be involved in the upcoming budget process. But I really don't know how you guys work. So I'm going to try to come back to all of your meetings between, you know, the budget, but just a couple of them, just, you know, so that when budget season starts, I'm not trying to come up to speed. The point I'm trying to make is, do you ever ask them what they want to tell you when there's not a budget on the line?
Oh, absolutely. What Ann and I did with our liaison, we set up the first Tuesday of every month that we would just walk in and someone was just wanted to have a stand-up meeting. Hey, what's going on? Just to see if anything really hot is going on.
And it's a
rather than anything
to talk about.
Not really energetic, just to see
it. Right.
And
just taking everybody's temperature.
5 or 10 minutes, fine, just walk away.
Right.
And
that's
it builds relationships.
That's right.
That kind of thing. And then as the season went on, we had more specifics. I mean, in fact, we were more passive than the director was wanting to explain to us more than we really were happy. We didn't come for it.
Right.
Details about the capital budget. We just came to say, hey, what's going on? And so we were received more than we expected.
That's right. And if you start doing that this time of the year before budget, what's nice about that is when the capital plan came out, none of it was a surprise to you.
Right.
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 Right. Absolutely. Speaking of the budget, though, and this is one of my pet peeves, we've got $25 million. And this advisory committee has its, we have influence on, not we're not kingmakers, we have influence on 9.4%. That's all. And then if you take the capital ends, that's rounding 5%. So let's say 15% of it. And so whenever we fall into the trap of saying manage the budget, or, you know, 15% is nothing. And we won't go into what the other is and who is responsible for it. In order to really manage the budget, somebody has to have a responsibility for it, accountability, and authority. And you cannot achieve, you can't manage anything unless you have the responsibility, the authority, and the accountability. So,
no, I understand.
That's why we are where we are.
I got it.
That's my editorial.
I appreciate your editorial. It's a reality.
Yeah. It surprised me. I thought, oh, man, we're going to get a dump.
And then we do find ourselves, working over $1,000, $150 here and there.
Let me add one thing, because this wasn't clear to me when I was on advisory. So when you get the capital requests and you get the budget, these are unvarnished requests, right? This is not something that Don Lowe or the selectmen have looked over and said, yeah, this is what we want to submit. You're getting this directly from the department heads, all of that stuff, without any editorial comment at all.
Right.
So, you know, you're in there with the machetes just clearing the path at that point.
You have to help me though, because my problem is that when I am told something is a priority and we kind of push it back and we tell them, okay, next year we'll address it, but then next year when they come back, it's not even on their list. Or it's way down the list. I'm going, how much of a priority could it have been?
But So you're talking about moves from the selectmen?
No, I'm talking about from the department when they go to capital planning and they prioritize.
Then that's the benefit of doing what Anne and Ted are doing now, which is they're not waiting to understand all, they're not waiting until budget season to understand all that stuff.
And I do
and
think
times will change. I mean, you definitely, you know, you get a wish list, and then you sort of push back and say, we're not going to be able to do this. Help me understand what, if you could only pick three things, what would it be? And you do a lot of what ifs.
Yeah, and I think that the department heads react either consciously or unconsciously to what advisory does with their wish list. So if a certain fire chief brought up all these two-way radios 1 year and then suddenly they didn't appear, he caught quite a bit of heck from us. There were a lot of questions asked about that. I shouldn't give a specific example, but I think they learn from their interactions with us what they can reasonably submit.
My thing is that wish list. To me, it's not a wish list. It's not supposed to be. I mean food, air, water, clothing, shelter, right? That's not a wish list. But I might want a purple jacket, then it becomes a wish list. You know, I'm trying to make you see that. For me, it's not a wish list. And then they give it to me, and then I'm looking at picking out what I should be giving them.
No, it's not a wish list, but...
What should you call it?
Well, you know, like I'll take the Why Quad Kill article, right? The culvert. It was a $500,000 request. And I looked at that and I was like, my head's exploding. So I sat down with Don and Joe and I said, I need to understand this better. I can't get my head around that number. And so what came out of it is we pushed $420,000 out into the future because that was for the construction itself, and we're only asked for $80,000 for the design. The other $480,000 we weren't going to spend for at least a year anyway, right? Because it's going to take a year to properly design the thing. And then we got to discussing about, you know, it's a really serious problem there. Right? If the water is literally coming up to some of the people's driveways and backyards there. And then from there we went into, yeah, well suppose that thing completely fails in October, November, or February. When you repair that, how the school bus is going to get around? And so that's where the emergency culvert repair came in, the $20,000 for that, that they're going to do this summer. Okay? So what we did was we pushed it out. We took off the warrant $400,000 and provided immediate relief to the folks whose backyards are being, okay? Now, now the other advantage of that, you know, and then we avoid any issues with the school buses, you know, other bad timing issues with closing Marquardt Hill Road for a few days. They'll be doing this at the low water mark of the year, which is typically what happens in July and August, and again, when there's no school buses running. The other thing is, instead of just having a $4,000 money held for that, the estimate may, once we have engineering, we may have a better number to offer the town next year.
So it's still a priority, but because...
But we looked at it, we broke it up into pieces that, A, provided fast relief, avoided a catastrophe if the weather led to one next year, and we still have the whole program going forward at the same rate it would have been before. But it was just a matter of, so we didn't change any priorities. We just understood how, you know, Joe was dealing with all these issues all at once, and we found that if we kind of teased out the separate issues, we can break it into different pieces. Now, that emergency culvert that they're going to put in, as much as possible, is going to be incorporated into the final design.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that's not going to be wasted money.
Oh,
yeah. Well, but I was just an iterative processing. I managed a bunch of departments. They all came with, you know, stuff that they wanted. But you have to take all the departments and say, okay, in the greater, you know, let's step back in the whole division, what are the priorities? Some people got what they wanted, but some people didn't. And I think it's not that dissimilar in a town budget process, because everybody puts in a good faith effort that might be, you know, a lot of hope
right.
on what they think they need. And then it's a question of how you balance it all within the framework of the budget.
So the other part of that is by moving that $400,000 out, you now make room for something else in the current year. Right?
No.
Yeah.
we don't have to worry about it until next year, kind of thing.
Yeah, I was wondering if throughout the years, is there a management emphasis? And management could be town administrator, could be board of selectmen, but a management emphasis to department heads and committees for conservation of cash or savings projects or, you know, doing things better, differently, benchmarking against best practices.
That's worked out with,
you know, is that part of the culture? Because I heard certain things.
They don't ask for money until, they don't borrow money until they're ready to spend it.
Not always.
Yeah, I mean, they wouldn't go out, let's say we didn't change the water quality filter, they wouldn't go out and borrow that. Was that going to be a borrowing or a...
Yeah. Okay. So the reason I asked about culture is through the year, I kind of heard things that kind of graded just like, ooh. And I didn't say anything, but then I recollected them. And one was a department that talked about, well, we asked people for their vision. And, yeah, you're going to get a whole big way in the world, you're not going to get, you know, you haven't set a return on investment, you haven't put a, you know, a metric on it that's going to rein in a vision exists. Another thing that a response we got, well, that's the easiest, and I'm not going to get into the specifics, but I thought, wow, you know, why not the best, or, you know, it's a little more effort, but it's more optimal. You know, so I'm thinking, well, this is our culture. And another one was we asked somebody something, oh, that can't be done. We're not really thinking much about it. And I said, well, that's our culture. And another one was, well, we could reduce this. And the answer was, well, that's only so much a month. Not very well. You know, so much a month is so much a month. It's savings. So we in this committee on a Tuesday night from January to March aren't going to change the culture, but the people who are day-to-day, and I don't know whether you have weekly staff meetings or people make the circuit and meet with directors and whatever. I don't know how it works, but somewhere people get the culture is developed. And I'm not saying it's a serious problem. I'm just saying,
no.
You know,
I think
they get a polish in the diamond, if you will, but, you know, it could be enhanced.
There's a couple of things. One is that for a long time, a couple of our major departments were always headed up by old people. And stuff just got done a certain way, which was generally accepted by everybody. Even though it wasn't necessarily the best one. And now we've got some people from outside of town who have come in and they're putting their own imprint on the departments. They're learning what our culture is. They haven't fully absorbed it yet, but that's a process that takes time. And I think the fact that we're getting good people from outside of town overall raises the level of professionalism.
Yeah, cross-pollination.
Yeah, in all that stuff. So, you know, it was this group that just last year completed the financial policies, you know, for the town. And I think what you're talking about, again, is a cultural issue. People are learning how we do business. That was one of the reasons I sat down with, you know, I think that was one of the reasons why I sat down with Joe, is I couldn't get my head around the $500,000 number. And, you know, so now he appreciates a little bit more how I think, I appreciate a little bit more how he thinks, and it's going to be continued to be a learning experience for both of us. So I hear what you're saying, it's just, it's not something you can...
Yeah, it might be something as simple as every board of selectmen meeting has a standing agenda item, savings items, and committees, departments are invited to, at any random time, submit a, hey, we found out a way to save in the call. And there's a standing item, and it has a certain priority. Just like a lot of meetings in my world where safety was always a standing agenda on every single meeting. So, anyway,
all right, well, I'll bring that up with Don, because he does have regular meetings with the department heads, and we'll see.
Savings might be in, turn the lights off, you know, this or that. It's a mindset thing.
Right. It's just, you know, but to the point you made before, there's really little, the budgets are pretty thin.
Right, and we did this when we were on the board. We tried to do the paper, just toilet paper and office paper, because it seems like every line item, every department has office supplies, and they overlap.
So I love this.
You know, I mean, so that's something we kind of let go by the wayside, because everybody, and you spoke that it's easier this way. One thing that might not be the economical way to do it. And it might be.
But we ended up, what we went with that was essential cabinet, right? So there was going to be one department that had all the supplies.
Wanted to, but I don't think it ever happened that way.
Okay.
Because it's not like that now.
Okay.
I think everybody has an office supply, has a supply budget.
Yeah. Yeah. We tried years ago to do just what you're saying.
Another thing kind of related to our process is that it strikes me that especially with certain departments, and I'll use Conservation Commission as an example, there's a huge asymmetry in expertise between us and the members of the commission and the conservation agent. And I think we've got to think, and maybe you have ideas, but of ways to, like, increase our fluency in that subject matter over the next few months, so that by the time we get to reviewing their budget or another similar department's budget, we are all kind of on the same page, just in terms of having a basic understanding of what they do. Because I will admit, like, I feel like every time I come across the conservation budget, I'm having to relearn, like, what do they mean by this? How is it different from that? And really, budget season is not the time to relearn that.
I didn't understand, and I'm saying this because you asked me if I had any ideas. I didn't understand why the police police department needed people with unions. I didn't understand why the police department needs people that it needs.
Oh, okay.
Right? It's like, we have this many officers, we have this many patrolmen, da-da-da-da-da-da. It's like, how do you come up with that? And I asked the chief to, you know, sit down with me and explain to me how this is going to work. He had charts, he had color graphs, he had everything that just showed me, here's how scheduling works. We do it this way because of this part of the contract. When we have a problem, the contract says we have to do this, and we've got to cover there. And he completely explained it to me. I walked out there saying, okay, I understand exactly what the staffing issues are right now. Right? Why, what, you know, when does the second sergeant operate? You know, stuff like that. And so I think it's fair game to, you know, you just finished the budget season, to go back to the departments and say, you know, I'm still not sure what this means. I'm not arguing with you about whether or not it's the correct number. I just want to understand how it's used and what it's used for. That's all. You're not trying to get them to change. You just, to your point, you're just trying to gain the technical expertise that they have.
Sis, you mentioned the word contract.
Someday I'm going to have the same conversation about patrol cars. I don't know when that's going to happen, but someday they'll have the same conversation about patrol cars.
Did you see that? Looking at contracts?
Yeah, and it says contracts is part of that non-9.4% that they look at. I think some discussion needs to be had around transparency for at least the chair of advisory to be able to be aware of what's going on at the time that it's being negotiated or being a backbench negotiator or something. I don't know what the proper role.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's legally a safe thing to do. But I can say, having been on advisory, when I was on advisory and contracts came out and it was like, holy smokes, where did that number come from? I've been sensitive about that and I've been bringing up that issue.
Availability of tonight, once they have been negotiated, are they public record?
Yeah, no.
All right, so we
at least we have
a
interview mirror.
Yeah, right, it's okay. You're better off reading the physics textbook and trying to work your way through the police contract because it's extremely dense and complicated. But even if you read one of those contracts, you're not going to be able to figure out how much what it means in terms of dollars and cents. Only the notchka can do that.
Are you about to become chair of the board?
No.
It's Stan?
Stan.
Okay. Because just when you mentioned the cruisers, one thing that came up a couple times was the need to have like a fleet review discussion workshop type thing out of the heat of the budget season. So I was just going to say, like, if you're interested, I would love to have us all get in a room and go over the fleet management. And I think Don Lowe said, because we're working with a new insurance carrier, it might dovetail with implementing new fleet management software as well.
I'll tell Don that I'm interested in having a broad discussion. And if you tell him that advisory, you know.
I wouldn't mind doing that with DPW as well.
Oh, yeah, I
bet you would just talk about police.
You know what? I would separate out passenger vehicles from heavy equipment. Mm-hmm. I would break them into a discussion. You know, if you're going to break them into a discussion, I would, you know, we just purchased a couple new vehicles, but they're more passenger types as opposed to heavy equipment because police, you know, DPW heavy equipment and fire department heavy equipment are two entirely separate animals.
I would agree with you, Bob, because I think that, you know, it's the turnover in heavy vehicles is much less frequent.
Right. And you know, the EMTs and the fire department and the police department aren't going to have anything to contribute to a discussion of the heavy equipment at the DPW line. So I think you want to break that into two separate discussions, one about, you know, the
it could be discussed separately, but I would bet we have all the VIN numbers racked up on one spreadsheet.
Yeah, but I
think
it is you know,
I thought we already have that.
We got that a year ago.
We've got much more. We have quite a bit, but I think there's a lot of, especially for the passenger vehicles, there's a lot of questions about how things get allocated when, like, the police department no longer needs it. What's the order for who it goes to after?
Well, let me throw out an idea I had when I was on advisory and the selectman shot it down. What I requested was for you know, police and the ambulance and not so much the fire. I want to know how much repairs cost every 5,000 miles. How much did you spend on maintenance for this vehicle between 15,000 and 20,000 miles? How much did you spend on, you know, between 20,000 and 25,000? Or make the gaps bigger if you want, make them $10,000. I don't want to make this a whole bunch of work. But I want to see which vehicles are actually declining the fastest.
Oh, absolutely.
And
it's not necessarily the oldest car that's costing you the most, right? But if we're routinely throwing away the oldest car because that's what the selectmen and everybody else expects to happen, we're shooting ourselves in the foot sometimes.
Yeah.
And we need to understand the difference between routine maintenance tires versus the unexpected, you know.
Right. So, you know, that's a path we can explore in the coming years.
It should be one spreadsheet per vehicle and really any maintenance.
I'm not going to get into a debate about how to do it. Believe me, there's plenty of cultural issues. This is one of those cultural issues things that's got to be overcome before you get into the details of how it's actually going to be.
It should be uniform across the country.
So that's
the process.
Everybody
should have a system. So I will definitely send an email to the town administrator, just putting this on the radar as like a summer project.
Yeah.
And hopefully it'll line up well with this fleet management software that I think we'll be getting access to, which might have a lot of the capabilities. I think it might have a lot of these capabilities. We have some transfers to get to, but I want to make sure there are other.
I have one more thing. This goes back to the micromanagement. And I think I already know the answer, but what's been your opinion of the analysis of propane purchases and contacts at the library? You strictly go by the they produce a budget and we say yay or nay, or maybe talk a little bit about it. That kind of concludes Ted doing research to say, yeah, you could save $10,000 a year, whatever the number was, by totally redoing how propane is obtained. I think it's a good idea to do that, but
I want to make sure I'm understanding your question. So I think before Ted or anybody else does a deep dive, they should make sure that they're invited to do that by the relevant, either the trustees or, in this case, you know, Kelly. I think we should try to avoid a situation where those types of questions are being asked in the heat of the budget season and holding up our ability to vote on it. It might be something where we identify it as like, hey, we think there's an opportunity for cost savings. We think that your budget is justified, but let's agree to follow up.
Sure.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, and I think, you know, based on what we learned this budget season, there are some areas where we could, you know, before you get into the, I want this much money, and we say yes or no, understand some of the underpinnings of how they come to that number. Do you have your thought of this? So, you know, it's just a mutual education exercise at this time of year.
Yeah, and I think that one of the tricky things is, so in that specific example, you're not a liaison to the library, right?
No, and when I made the presentation, I didn't send a peek about nothing that is after the fact, because I didn't know. I just seemed out of place.
Right.
And then did some checking and then mentioned it to Joe because I thought he was part of the loop. And I mentioned it to Don. And he says, no, I have no jurisdiction over the library. I talked to the trustees. So.
Yeah. And so in that case, too, I think it's important. Like, if we're representing to departments that certain people are the liaisons, we should try to have at least initially, that conversation to flow through the liaison, and then if the department says, hey, yeah, we do want Connie to dig into this, or Brian to dig into that, then you can work with them directly. That's, I think, a way of keeping the process clean. Because I have to say, at a certain point this year, I felt like the right hand didn't know what the left hand was doing. Like, when it came to all the conversations that people were happening, and I think it all comes from a place of wanting to really understand, but it got a little sloppy. Okay. So, I'll move on to transfer requests. Do you want to stick around for that?
It should go quick, yeah.
Yeah, it should. So, in these, I spoke with them today, and they're going to be getting, we're probably going to be dealing with lots of transfer requests between now and the end of the year. But we debated, like, do we want to hold them for department and then try to do them all at once? But she said for accounts receivable and payable purposes, we want to try to get these out of the way. So the first one, and I don't have copies for everyone, so I'll just have to read it out loud, is a request for $52 to be transferred to one of the insurance line items, 194-5740. So we have, basically, there's an additional vehicle that we had to add to the coverage. So our premium is going up slightly, and we need $52 to cover the increased premium. So, I mean, I don't know if we're going to get another one of these, but it's not a huge...
Yes, so the answer is that going to be every quarter or every month or whatever, whenever the...
No. We should, when we get our renewal, this should be...
Oh, I see. Okay.
So that's the first transfer request.
Also move. Second, if I get the insurance fund advisor.
Second is. Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Do we know what vehicle that is?
I think it is the police. It's a police vehicle. Because it's they're adding to the scheduled property coverage, $42,000, which is the amount of
person.
All right. So I'll do all that signing later. The next one is a request from the treasurer, and it's in the amount of $696.59 to the unemployment compensation line, which is, well, it's really long, but it's 51720. It's the new number. I got an email from her. Kristen believes that this is a short-term unemployment, like maybe 1 month, because we only got an invoice for 1 month, and there have been subsequent months that we should have been invoiced for if this was still an active claim. So she can't guarantee it, but she's fairly confident that this is just for the month of April 2019. It's unrelated to that other one that we approved a couple of weeks ago.
What was that amount again?
69. Yeah, it's for that. And it's for the month of April 2019. So is there a motion?
Some of them.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, and then the last transfer is a request for $654.34. To be transferred to sewer. We only have $69.40 left in that line. And according to this, we got two invoices from Whitewater, which is the wastewater solutions contractor, for $361.87, and another one for $361.87. So we're in excess of the amount that we budgeted last year.
So how's that?
The fee, according to this, it says the fee is intended to reflect increased costs for VOC sampling. I don't know. Does anyone know what DOC is?
That's for sewer, and that's for the treatment plant up here for the sewer. So this is telling us that they routinely test for VOCs in there, and the price for doing that test is gone up.
Okay.
All right.
Is that what it said, or there was an additional test?
Well, that's what's unclear to me.
And if it's additional sampling, why?
Well, there have been, let me say that there have been reports that water in Ayer, in Harvard, and in Clemson.
This is water only from the sewers.
Right.
This is wastewater.
Right. That's true. Okay.
This is only from municipal buildings and the school.
Right. This would only, I don't know if the BTL or whatever it is that's been detected all around Bolton, drinking water is a VOC.
We're talking about what in drinking water all around Bolton.
It's a compound that has been found by the state in drinking water in Ayer, in Harvard, in Clinton. From Devon's.
Right.
But I don't know that much more.
All right, but remember, Ayer, Devon's is in Ayer.
I know that.
And, you know, but I think we're too remote.
I
live there.
I don't know. I have no idea whether that's the reason.
Joe, if that's drinking water, it could be the methyl butyl tertiary.
That's exactly what it is.
Yeah. Gasoline.
Clinton is on.
But this is waste
on the river.
Clinton is off of water.
Yeah.
If Clinton's got that in its water, that means the whole metro Boston.
Forget that I brought it up.
Maybe it was Lancaster.
That's irrelevant. No, it wasn't. I was surprised that it was Clinton in the article.
So the question this begs is who authorized additional testing?
So,
the cost of a specific test has gone up.
Yeah, that's
wonderful.
That's
one. If they can just decide, if somebody other than the PE decides to do additional testing,
we don't know if it's additional testing. I think the more interesting question is, if it is additional testing, why?
Right. Right. Well, and so here's the other. So
is it just existing testing that got more expensive?
I'll read the exact language. It says, per previous notification, contract fee is amended to reflect increased costs for VOC sampling. But what you have to understand is, this... I'm just noticing this now. It looks like this notice initially gets sent to the regional school district.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's possible that whatever discussion was had related to whether there's going to be increased sampling or the cost of sampling or increasing might have happened with somebody totally out of town hall.
Okay.
And we're just on the hook because...
Well, we should know.
But is this a regional school or is this for
Okay. Right, well, who's your liaison to the schools?
Yes.
So, there's a phone call there at least to school committee.
Yeah.
See, I'm a big believer. If you get an invoice and you haven't agreed to it, you say, hey, I'm going to agree to this.
No, I know. It's just...
So I guess we're stuck between a rock and a hard place because it says that there's a finance charge of 1.5% per month on unpaid balances after 30 days from the date of invoice. So if we don't approve these, we might be racking up charges. But I mean, would you?
Well, I would think, if they owe us a credit, I can't well, I don't know that they pay you to do that.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to get an answer to this in the next 5 days.
Okay.
So I'd say pay it, and then, you know, then go see if there's some other tampons need. So.
Yeah. I mean, your concern is, like,
I would not pay it, as long as you're in discussion over them, I don't think they can make up 1% and go away. That's just boilerplate. But, you know, I don't know,
you ask for an entire invoice of all their monthly services.
You know, what percentage an increase is?
I think it must be...
An increase of 360 bar. What the heck is their base cost? I mean, what's the percentage? It just sounds
maybe the equipment for the test comes from China. I don't know.
I mean, the GC mass spec is pretty
impressive. Yeah, I hope it's not all 61 a month.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'm going to vote in Dallas anyway.
All right, so will someone move?
I'll be glad to call and get an answer.
Is that going to be 361 a month, or is that just 362 charging 361 for the year?
I think it's probably going to be, based on the fact that there are two invoices for May and April, I think we'll probably get one in June and July.
Mm-hmm.
Or one in June.
Then I think this committee deserves to see the entire invoice.
The invoice going on.
Yeah.
Not just the incremental charges.
And how much are
the who's paying the rest of the invoice?
It's probably all.
With budgeted, whose budget?
It's from the treasurer, right? In request.
Well, whose budget? It says exceeded amount of budget. Whose budget is it coming out?
But wait a minute. If they ran out of money in April, why are they sending only the incremental amount for May?
They're not. What they're sending is there's an invoice dated 5/1/2019, which I think is for April, and then there's an invoice dated 5/31/19 for May.
Okay.
So that's the cost for the month. It's not whole. I mean, that must be
right.
The monthly is. So what budget is that coming out of?
So we have the town has the 440 budget that would be coming out of
right.
The sewer budget.
So maybe what's happened is that because of the rising costs, they run through that whole budget already. And the NASCA just sent out the expenditure ledger week or so ago. I haven't looked at this particular line.
There's $70 left in it.
Okay, so that's the monthly charge for everything, and the reason you ran out of money early is because of the increased testing for the VOCs.
Mm-hmm.
That's what happened. This isn't an incremental $300 just for VOCs.
Yeah, it's the monthly
bill.
Yeah.
Okay, some more questions.
Yeah, it's still
going up from 70 to 300.
You'd expect that if we had 70 in this account, we'd be seeing two different numbers. Or the number that we have here would be the number of your invoices times 2 minus 70 or something. I don't know.
Well, it says per contract. Wouldn't someone have to notify us if there was an increase?
Probably says they can pass along our infrastructure.
Is there a request for exactly those two numbers combined?
Yeah.
Yes, for 36187, 36187.
Why don't we table it, and I will come in tomorrow if I'm so directed to. And there are file cabinets at the end of the office across the hall, and I will go through and I will find the exact.
We're not just commissioning.
Of course.
Yes, okay.
With the invoices, and I'll chase the rabbit.
Is that a motion? Well, before we do that, I do want to find out. I want to find out what everybody's schedule is the next 2 months to make sure that we're all going to be able to have a forum for future meetings to get these things approved in a timely manner. You know, like,
because you can approve it. Pending tests.
You're traveling?
I am traveling. I won't be back until the night of June 4th, which is a Tuesday. I'll have the next couple of weeks.
But you wouldn't be here on June 4th?
No, I won't be back until, really June 5th. My plane lands at midnight on that Tuesday.
Okay.
But I come in Wednesday, I'm going to be next on Wednesday instead of Tuesday.
But basically, you wouldn't be able to get to a Tuesday meeting here until June 11th.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then,
can I just remind people who should be talking about?
Well, I'm leaving my home, and everybody is on the line. I have kids. They don't need my home. I have to stop cooking.
That's
fucking.
Okay. So you're going on a vacation.
I've got to learn
how much to appreciate.
I know. I would have never have said it ahead because we've been through this before.
Yeah,
had
okay.
I not known everything. I'm the only one traveling.
Is there anyone else with limited availability the next several Tuesdays?
Several. Is there Tuesday 26th or 27th? I'm not available.
The day after Memorial Day?
Yeah,
whatever that Tuesday
whatever
is.
Whatever that Tuesday is.
Okay.
That's
your
answer. I can tell you when I'm not available.
Tuesday 28th?
Yeah, but the 28th is not available.
Mm-hmm. And actually, other than that, I am. I am not available this week at all.
Oh, yeah, so that basically Memorial Day week. What about you, Ann?
Ann, you
help me distribute it. Our cats will get off.
What was that, Ann? Sorry.
I have no particular place to go anywhere, so.
Okay.
Well, I'm glad enough to go besides the trumpet.
All right, so then we could potentially get together next Tuesday if we need to, or the first Tuesday of June, but you would be there.
Right.
Okay.
Worst case is we're at, 1% of the
16
months. Well, just bring it up at Domino's cost saving in the union.
Okay.
What you go back to, Craig, is in the contract, you're probably set to pay properly prepared invoices. And this is not properly prepared.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice to
you. Some adjective.
Oh, okay.
So do we need a motion to table?
Sure.
All in favor say aye.
It's going to be what? It's going to be information.
You.
How?
You and I together?
Yeah.
I don't want to do anything unless you know about it.
Okay. Yeah. I think.
And you can be the one person.
I think what I'll do is I'll make first contact with Linda and Natasha.
Okay.
And then if it seems like there's going to be some, complicated document review, I'll get you all those documents.
Okay. Is there anything I need to find your research? I want the parents to do this.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Yeah, okay.
All right, and the last thing on our agenda is any other advisory committee committee business, including approving minutes or liaison updates.
Okay, this is part of the other, this is a draft of a letter covering the three items that we discussed that we thought maybe the Board of Selectmen could contact our legislative delegation and the governor's office about three fairly, well, the last one particularly, very minor differences in regulations that we think could be. But we don't, the town does not have the authority to change that might give us a tiny bit more control over our budget. Do you have a copy, Bob?
No. Craig, previous meeting.
That was it.
Whether by permission or not.
No, that's all right. I have an extra copy. And since I only just submitted it, we may want to review it for another meeting.
Yeah, why don't we review it outside the meeting?
Yeah, let's review it outside the meeting.
But I think what might be worthwhile is if there's any history to this. I thought maybe Karen Polito and Baker reached out to communities and said, what's on your mind? What can we do to kind of make things more efficient or saving, you know? And if we could somehow refer to that, you know, key on that and say, we in response to,
okay, well, that, if I have to
we're submitting.
I mean, I think it's.
But I don't know much about it.
I don't know either.
Well, I'll explain right now. So, basically, a couple of years ago, there was the Municipal Modernization Act. I want to say it was 2016. The Baker administration is keen on doing like municipal modernization round two. And so they have put out general asks about things that people might want included in the Municipal Modernization Act. And so I've given it a little bit more thought. And one thing we may want to talk about is like, yeah, we would obviously want to clue in Don Lowe and the Board of Selectmen, but the ultimate audience might be one of the legislative directors at the Mass Municipal Association. The reason I'm saying that is I think it might be, we might be more likely to get to the right person if we get this onto her agenda instead of us just sending it as the FinCom of Bolton. But these are the types of things that these are the types of ideas that people are throwing out for potential inclusion in the municipal
market. And I know Kate Hogan, because I've discussed this with her, she said that MMA has very strong clout on Beacon Hill. Because I asked her about a specific legislative reform once, and she said, well, the MMA is against it, and it's not going anywhere. So,
have you investigated finding people at the MMA who have dealt with these issues? To see how other towns have approached you?
So, did you send this today or was it? I can't remember when you
just today.
Okay, just because what I was going to say is I have a bit of a connection to Lisa Adams, who's the legislative director, so I was going to give her a call and talk about these things to find out whether there are other folks.
I agree with your assessment of where to plug this in.
Right.
But
I think we should certainly let them.
Advisory or that's from a bunch of people?
I think we should let the town. I think that.
To kind of not get people's feathers ruffled.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think it's advisory.
No, I don't think it is either.
Yeah, I mean, we can write the letter and other people can sign it and whatever.
Right.
Anyway. That's to be.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I think we don't want to initiate something like this ourselves.
We can initiate,
but I mean, we don't want to be we don't want to signatory.
I think you got to be careful here because Don has conversations with Kate Hogan and other elected representatives all the time.
Right.
The topics that he's discussing with them are too numerous for him to describe. And for this to come out of the blue is either going to interfere with what he's doing, detract from what he's doing, or it's going to be disregarded because it's not coming from God, kind of thing. So, I think it's fair of you to go and investigate what the alternatives are here, but before you make any formal statements,
Oh, we would not.
You've got to get his concurrence, his
buy-in, and probably your board's concurrence.
I will tell you, as I sit here right now, I would probably follow Don's recommendation unless someone can come up with some unimaginable reason why I shouldn't. But that's, I think in this particular case, I want to make sure this is, mixes in with I want to make sure we spend our political capital wisely.
Mm-hmm. We can talk outside.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't talk outside.
I personally agree.
Two board members.
All right, anything else? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Awesome. All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Good night, Anne.
Bye, Anne.